Hello everyone. In this episode we're going to be working a bit with methods and variables, basically just getting comfortable programming with them. So here in Unity I've got my custom layout set up from the previous episode. I'm just going to head over to the project window and right click, create new C# script, and I'll just call this something like episode 4. And we can double click to open that up in MonoDevelop. So this is the default text that we're faced with when we create a new script in Unity. Don't worry, by the way, if your colors are different from mine. This is just something that we can customize under syntax highlighting in the preferences, and obviously it doesn't change the way that the code behaves at all. So most of the things here you should be familiar with from the first few episodes. For example, we've got the class keyword followed by the name of the class, episode 4, and then the colon mono behavior we discussed means that it inherits from mono behavior, which just gives us some base functionality. For example, the start method, which gets called automatically at the start of the game, and the update method, which gets called once per frame while the game is running. Remember that the void keywords means that these methods don't return anything, and any text that follows a double slash on the same line is just a note that we can leave either to ourselves or to other programmers explaining what a bit of code does. The only thing that we haven't talked about are these two lines at the top here, which are called namespaces, and for the time being, we are going to ignore those. So to start with, I'd like to look at how we can print stuff to the Unity console. So MonoBehavior has a print method, so if we just write the word print, you can see the IntelliSense tool is going to give us some information about print. For example, it's a public static void, and it takes in an object for the message. And we've got this little summary here as well, logs message to the Unity console, so that sounds like what we want. So if we open parentheses, we now need to pass in an object, and it turns out in C#, we'll talk more about this later, but most things are objects. So for example, we can pass in a string. So let's just write start. So just the word start inside of quotation marks, then close the parentheses, and remember to add a semicolon for the end of the line. Let's do a similar thing in the update method. Print, open parentheses, let's print the word update, and close parentheses, semicolon. So now if we save and go into Unity, we're going to want to attach the script to an object in our scene. So let's create a new empty game object and just drag that onto the object. You'll see it pops up in the inspector here. And then if we press play, you can see that this is being printed out into the console. If we just toggle collapse, then you can see a nice condensed view of it. And we can see update has been printed by now 500 times, so it's being printed every frame as we'd expect. Let's go back into our episode 4 class, and let's quickly discuss something called variable scope. So say I were to create a variable inside of a method, let's take the start method, and I'll just create an integer variable, so int, call that x, and assign it a value of 0. What happens now is when this method is run, the integer x is created, but then as soon as the method has finished running, the variable x is destroyed from the computer's memory. Because of this, we'll only create a variable inside of a method if we want to temporarily store some information for use in a calculation, for example. We call x a local variable. It was created between this opening and closing pair of braces, so it is local. In other words, it can only be used by code which also exists between that same pair of braces. If I try access it from somewhere else, say the update method, x equals 5, we get this little error saying that x doesn't exist in the current context. So just to hopefully drive this point home, say I create an opening and closing pair of braces. This defines a new local scope. So I can still access x in here, x equals 5, for example, because this is part of the scope in which x was defined. However, if I create an integer y inside of here, I cannot use y outside of this pair of braces. If I did try, say, y equals 5 out here, for instance, we'd get the same error again because y no longer exists. So because local variables get destroyed at the end of their scope, we obviously can't use them to keep track of things across the entire game, such as the player's health. So what we can do instead is create a variable like that outside of any method, usually at the top of our class. Let's use the example of keeping track of the number of frames that have passed in our game. So I'll create an integer called frame count, And notice the convention for naming variables. We start with a small letter, and then each subsequent word starts with a capital letter. We can say frame count equals 0. And just to give a bit of terminology, this part where we give the name of the variable and the type of the variable is called the variable declaration. Here where we give it its initial value is called the initialization. When we're creating these non-local variables, the initialization is optional. If we leave this out, it will get initialized to its default value, which for integers is 0. So now to count the number of frames, we're just going to go into the update method, since that's called once per frame, and add 1 to the frame count. So we can say frame count is equal to frame count plus 1. Now, there is a shorthand way of writing this, which is simply frame count plus equals 1. This is saying that 1 gets added to the original value. So you'll generally see this instead because it's, of course, much shorter. Let's now print out our frame count. So we can say frame count. Then let's save this and go into Unity to run it. And we can see that now our frame count gets printed out over here. If we wanted to print the words frame count next to it, we could add quotation marks, frame count, and then we just say plus. So the plus operator is not only for numbers, we can also add things onto strings. So here we're adding the value of frame count onto this frame count string. Let's save that and run. And you can see that working in the bottom right here. All right, so we've briefly touched on variables. Let's now take a look at a practical example of a method. So say we want a method to calculate the distance between two points. So if we're given two points defined by the coordinates x1, y1 and x2, y2, we can of course use Pythagoras' theorem to find the distance. So we'd say the change in x, or delta x, is equal to x2 minus x1, and the delta y is equal to y2 minus y1, and then the distance is the square root of delta x squared plus delta y squared. So in our code, we'll want this method to return the value of the distance, so we'll give it a return type of float, and then we can call this method something like getDistance between two points. Notice the naming convention for a method here. It's exactly the same as variables, except the first letter is a capital. You might wonder why Unity hasn't followed this naming convention for their print method, and I'm not sure, but don't use that as an excuse to not follow the convention yourself. Let's now create our opening and closing parentheses, followed by the opening and closing braces. So we'll want to pass the coordinates of the two points into this method. So hopefully you remember we can declare the variables inside of these parentheses here. So we say float x1, comma, float y1, and then for point 2, we'll say float x2, comma, float y2. So now we can create a local variable, delta x, is equal to x2 minus x1, and float delta y is equal to y2, minus y1. So next we'll want to create a float called something like distance squared and set that equal to delta x times delta x plus delta y times delta y. Alright, so we've got the squared distance. In order to get the actual distance, we now want to get the square root of distance squared. So to get the square root, we can use something called mathf, which, as you can see over here, is a struct, which we haven't learned about yet, but in this case it behaves pretty much identically to a class. So this has a method called square root, which, as you can see from this pop-up, takes in a float f and returns the square root of that number. So it's returning a float, so we can set our float distance variable directly to the result of this method. So mathf.squareroot of distance squared. Alright, all we need to do now is return the distance, so we write the return keyword, followed by distance, and as always, don't forget the semicolon. Alright, so now, say in the start method, we wanted to set float distance equal to, we can say get distance between two points, and it's generated this little pop-up for us saying that this method returns a float, takes in x1, y1, x2, and y2, and we can pass in, say, 0 and 5, and then our second point could be 10 and 15. And just like that, we found the distance. Let's print it out. So print distance. All right, let's save and see what that distance happens to be. Let me just comment out this print frame count line, otherwise that's going to get lost in a wall of text. So just remember to save, of course, and then press play. So that distance happens to be 14.14214. Before we end off for this episode, I'd like to give an example of what happens if we make a mistake in our code. Say, for example, I forget the semicolon at the end of this line. So I'll delete that, save, and go into Unity. You can see this error message pop up in the console saying unexpected symbol, float. And if we double click on the error message, it will take us to where the error is occurring. Now, the reason it's saying unexpected symbol float is it doesn't really care about paragraphs. It's reading this as being one line, and this doesn't make sense. Delta x times delta x plus delta y times delta y float. You can see why the float symbol was unexpected. It doesn't make sense here. So from this, we can figure out that we need to add the semicolon after delta y so that it knows that the line ends there. So that's one example of an error that could occur. Let's look at one more example. Say we forget to make this a float, and instead we say that it's a void method, but we're still trying to return the distance. If we now save and go into Unity, we can see that we actually have three errors now, but they're all being caused by the same thing. So we always start with the topmost error message, and we can see this one saying, cannot implicitly convert type void to float. Let's double click on that, and it says the error is coming from here because we're trying to set a float variable equal to a method which returns void. So from that we can immediately tell that this should be a float, and if we save and go into Unity, of course, all three of those error messages have now disappeared. All right, that's everything for this video. I encourage you to practice what you've learned of methods in variables so that you can get comfortable working with them. Until next time, cheers.